We're continuing on our question and answer time regarding our roots in Youth with a Mission and my own personal roots that would be influential on Youth with a Mission. And these are questions given by the staff and students here in Lausanne. And one of the questions had to do with why did we begin our schools in Switzerland? We presently have 56 schools as of 8 months ago. I think that's a little out of date now. But 56 schools around the world training workers for the kingdom on every continent of the world. And the first one was the one we're in right now. In 1968, God had been speaking, well, it was really 67, that God had been speaking to Darlene and to me, my wife and I, regarding the need of training, greater training in Youth with a Mission, which started out with a thrust of evangelism. We'd had short-term training only, but the Lord began to show us the need of this area of training. And if you'll remember the history of the time, when Youth with a Mission began, and this was one of the questions, there were other organizations that God was raising up at the same time. A few I had become aware of, two of them in particular. One was Teen Challenge with David Wilkerson. And this was in the urban area, specifically directed to gangs and to drug addicts. There was also the campus ministry of Dr. Bill Bright, starting on the university at the UCLA campus, and this began a widespread university movement, and it has gone beyond the university campuses now. And it's one of the largest movements now in the world. These both started in the 50s, and as I shared with you, it was 1953, when I was still a teenager, I was starting to have the stirrings of God in that direction. So we began in 1960, but also around that time, Operation Mobilization was beginning. Other groups that I didn't know about were beginning, but David Wilkerson spoke out publicly in the early 60s, declaring that there was going to be a move of God among young people where thousands upon thousands of young people would turn to Christ. This was fulfilled in the Jesus Revolution. And at that time, multiplied thousands of young people came into the body of Christ. The one thing that was so needed was teaching. Now, this really hadn't yet occurred as God was beginning to speak to us regarding training. And I find God always prepares ahead of time for those things that are going to take place. In the 60s, it was evangelism. In the 70s, it was training. In the 80s, it is mercy ministries, unity, and evangelism that the Holy Spirit is emphasizing. And so you can see the various decades as we're moving along through history, how God has his hand, his direction, and his plans that are taking place. So in 67, when God began to speak to us, he showed us that we were to have a school of evangelism. I've never heard that title prior to that time, to my knowledge. It came in prayer. The concept was we were to have it in Switzerland. I didn't know anyone in Switzerland. Thirdly, we were to have it on a basis of short-term training, 3 months, plus a field trip, plus outreach. And fourthly, we were to have visiting professors. That is, teachers that would come in from the front lines of that which we were to emphasize and share out of their life experience. So it would be like an Elijah's mantle falling on the young Elishas. The other concept that God gave to us in this school of evangelism was that it was to be total immersion. That is, no outside jobs, no outside interests, just intensive. Because if we had a whole lot of things going on where people were coming and going and just taking a class and leaving, we couldn't do what we had to do in such a short time. So it was to be intensive. And of course, one of the concepts was apprenticeship. That is, you must move into action or you haven't learned the subject. And so it was that. The basic outline of the course was threefold. The first had to do with the messenger, the person. And this meant God's dealings in the lives of the students in order to prepare them for their ministry. The second had to do with the message and focusing on that which we were to share that would be used of the Holy Spirit to change the lives of the people. And the third was the methods of evangelism in reaching the lost. Now, as God had dealt with us on this, we began to prepare to go overseas and did so. We were leaving in January. And we still didn't know anyone in Switzerland. We were just going to come to Switzerland. And the day before we left on a Saturday. Friday morning, Willard Cantillon, a man of God that God has used in many ways, including the pioneering of television, Christian television, and evangelism worldwide, was seeing my father. He's been a friend of the family for some time. And in his making an appointment with my dad, he said, is Lauren in town? And Dad said, yes. He said, would you ask him if he would come and meet with us for breakfast on Friday morning? Dad said, well, he's getting ready to leave for overseas tomorrow, but I'll see. I felt it was of God. I went to see him. Willard took me aside, and he says, I have a word from the Lord for you. He said, this is not my involvement. This is for you. You are to start, the Lord tells me, a school of evangelism in Switzerland, and you're to have visiting teachers. And he said, here's a name of a man who owns a hotel in Switzerland. And I thanked him, and that's all it was, and I left. I came here, and it was a Mr. John Owens who owned the Hotel Rosat in Chateaudet. And I came and met him, and I rented from him. We signed an agreement for the annex of the hotel to start our first school. That's an hour and a half away from here or so. And so we came back to the United States. I was ministering in a place called Rockford, Illinois. And there in that particular, it was an auditorium situation. I was speaking with Leonard Ravenhill and Duncan Campbell, the three of us. We were all staying in the same home together, which happened to be the home of Mark Spangler's father. And as you know, Mark and Eva Spangler have been on staff here. Well, this was even before Mark was saved. So as we were there in the home together, it was time for us to announce the school to the public. And this is all, you can do all the work, you know, behind the scenes, get everything ready. But when it comes to announcing to the public, you know you have to be right. And everything had worked out right. And I said to the Lord, and Darlene was praying with me, and we just put it before the Lord. And we said, Lord, today we're supposed to call the office and tell them to go ahead and put the announcement in the mail. It was all ready to go. And I said, before we do that, would you give us another word of encouragement? We walked out of our room. Duncan Campbell, did I say Campbell McAlpine? Duncan Campbell walked out of his room at the same time. Now, Duncan Campbell is the man that God had used in the Hebridean revival up in Scotland, where he was a minister of the Church of Scotland, and he moved in there preaching the gospel, and God shook that place. And many wonderful miracles took place. Well, when Duncan Campbell walked out, he looked at me, and his eyes had been red. He'd obviously been before the Lord in an earnest, deep way. And he looked at me, and he said, "Lauren, do you have a school? God's just told me to speak at your school." I said, "We do now." And he spoke every year here in Lausanne. In fact, until he died here. He spoke his last message right here. And he was videotaped on that. It was very difficult for him to be videotaped. He said, "Lauren," he says, "you know, I don't even watch television." And he says, "I don't have a television. And you sure this is okay?" I said, "Brother Campbell, God wants to preserve that which you have to use beyond your life." Ordinarily, he wouldn't even allow himself to be taped on just audio tapes. And he allowed us to do that as well. So it was very special. In fact, I really enjoyed a very special relationship with him. He was one of the great influences on my life. His input into the school had to do with the method of revival in evangelism. And it was also the message, and he was dealing with the messengers, all in one. And Don came to him his last time here, I believe, and Don Stevens, and said to him, "Oh, we have such a hunger for a move of God." God had been moving, and there was a lot of things taking place. And he said, "When can we see revival in our own lives?" He says, "I've never seen anything greater than I've seen in the last two nights right here at YWAM, because God was moving in such depth in our lives. And we didn't see the, as they saw in the Hebrides, literally building shake and other things, but we saw people shake. In other words, our inner man was shaken to the core. And God used him in a way to lay a special foundation in our hearts in the way of hunger. I don't think we'll ever be satisfied in YWAM until we see revival at a large scale. And I don't want us to ever be satisfied." He took me just before, a few months before he passed away, with him throughout the Hebrides Islands. And I would preach in English and he would preach in Gaelic. And he would take me to the cities where God moved. And he would describe what took place in each one of these cities, and then introduce me to the people that were there that had been deeply involved in the movements. It was a tremendous experience. We were standing out in front of a hall one night where we were to speak, and he said, "It was right here, Lauren, that we had 15 Baptist preachers that had flown in from California hearing of the revival. And they were all standing out here. And suddenly angels began to sing over us. And we heard the heavenly choir sing right out in the open." And some fabulous experiences he shared with me. And we both had an awareness that somehow we were walking the last steps before he was to be taken up in his chariot. But I didn't understand fully, of course, what God was saying when he said, "Start a school of evangelism." But God began to multiply the school of evangelism in a rapid way. Now, one of the things we had is an emphasis always, because we were to bring men of God that were used on the front lines because of the fruit of their ministry. And one of the questions is, how did we choose our teachers? God would speak and reveal certain people we would see the fruit of certain people, and then I would watch how God would confirm it to my heart who I was to choose to speak. And he cautioned me about choosing people just because I knew them or they were my friends and they would come. But it was around those three messages that they had to have something that God spoke to them. For example, I was in the home of Jim and Joy Dawson in New Zealand. And the way I went to New Zealand was David Ravenhill, Leonard's son, was in school at Bethany Fellowship in Minneapolis. And I went there to speak, and David said, I'm going to New Zealand. Would you come down sometime? And, of course, he was a student in college, and it really wasn't something that he could offer in a great way, but God began to work on my heart. And about a year later, I wrote to him, and I said, God has told me to come down to New Zealand. I didn't know why, but this was just simply a directive of God. Within 2 hours before I got on the plane, I still didn't have the money to get the ticket. And God provided for it just in the last 2 hours. And it was such an extra boost of encouragement. I could get on the plane not knowing what I was going to do in New Zealand, but I was on an obedience walk. And so as I arrived, I picked up the phone that he wrote back and said, good, when you arrive, call me at so-and-so, and gave me a telephone number. I called the telephone number. He wasn't in. Someone else was there, and they said, oh, you're Lorne Cunningham. He said, get on a certain seaplane, and that will take you out to a little island that just off the coast of New Zealand, and you're to speak at a conference. And I said, when? This afternoon. So I'd flown all night. I got on the little plane, went out there, and this conference was at the what eventually became known as Orama Fellowship, and the Great Barrier Island of New Zealand, not the one of Australia. And it was a little barrier island, actually. But mighty things of God took place there. One thing, and it's the only other place I've heard of it in the world other than in Greece, there was an atheist. They dealt with people on drug problems and all kinds of... It was a rehabilitation center, as well as a Christian conference center. And there was an atheist there, that young lady that just couldn't believe in God for anything. She said, if I could see a sign, a miracle, she said, I would believe. Well, Dorothy Winger, Nev Winger's wife, he was the director of the ministry. She said, well, you're going to see a miracle. It's 10:30 in the morning. The food barge didn't come in from the mainland. And because of that, we don't have any food for lunch. But God has promised us we will have food. Within 30 minutes, there was a big racket on the beach. Now, the beach there was all rocks. And somebody ran out to see what it was, and there were fish flopping on the rocks. And they picked up their meal from the rocks. And so this was the kind of place it was. It was a fabulous place. And as I ministered there, there were people from every denomination, Protestant and Catholic, were there, and they just wanted to know God. That's all. That was the only rule. And so they had a group of people in leadership over it, and Nev Winger and Milton Smith and Wynn Fountain. And that's Jeff Fountain's father, and Jim and Joy Dawson. Now, they always prayed together and would listen to God, get a word from the Lord, and whatever he said, that's what they would do. And they would pray about who would speak and what they would speak on, and God would tell them. And that's the way they moved. And they had never asked a speaker to come in and pray with them, because a lot of people didn't move in that direction, but they felt God said for me to come in and pray with them. I came in, and they said, this is the way we do it, and I said, fine. And so we all prayed, and they said, what did you get, Lauren? I got this, and they got the same thing, and they said, I didn't know this was going on in their hearts. They said, well, Lord, that is confirming to us. And this is something that I had learned as a child, just growing up, listening to God. And through this, the Dawsons asked me to come and stay in their home. They asked how long I was to stay. I told them I was going to be there a few weeks. Lord had told me to launch Youth with a Mission in the nation. And they said, well, we have a prophet's chamber in the basement level of our home, and we'd like to invite you to stay there. I said, well, we're going to start a crusade in Auckland, We're going to have an outreach, and I gave them the date about 10 days hence. And so I was going to be sharing. Now, at the Great Barrier Island, there were people like Riona Peterson, Ross Tooley, Winky Prattney, Barry Austin, different ones. Just, you can hear them in Youth with a Mission now around the world. Well, I went over to the mainland, and the Lord called me into a fast, so I couldn't go out and recruit. So I prayed and fasted, and on the last day of my fast, it was just a one-week period of time, on the last week, the last day, the following day, we started the crusade, and there were 55 people that showed up to go out witnessing, including the ones I've just named, plus Kalafi Mawala, and quite a few others. So out of that group, there was released out of the nation. And some have asked the question, why, with New Zealand being such a small nation, are so many in Youth with a Mission and in such strategic roles? The majority of the eldership, the spiritual leadership on the ship, are from New Zealand. The key positions on the ship, the captain, the chief engineer, the chief steward, the pastor of the ship and head of evangelism, the chief fireman, are all from New Zealand. And here's a little country doing a lot in a major way across the world. At that time, there was a real teaching inside New Zealand that everything, you know, should stay local. And here Lauren came with saying, go. And it was just a bottle to be uncorked. It was ready. God had them ready. And that year, on our crusades within New Zealand as well as outside, we saw over 200 New Zealanders participate. We went to Fiji. First crusade in Auckland, Kalafi Mawala came to me, and he was just turned 18, and he had just been saved a few weeks. He was on fire for God, and he said, oh, would you go to bring a group to my nation of Tonga? And I said, we'd pray about it, and we felt the Lord said yes. And so we went to Tonga, and I was somewhere else in the world, so Jim Rogers led that team to Tonga. Another young man, I was up in Seattle just prior to that in an outreach there, and a red-headed young man walked in to the back on the last day of the outreach. And he wrinkled up his eyes and said, what's this all about? And Darlene saw him, walked up to him and said, this is called Youth with a Mission, and this is what you're to be a part of. His name was Dean Sherman. The following week, he went to Tonga, and he didn't even have a passport when he walked into the back of the church. And he had to have some quick miracles to take place for him. And he took off with his suitcase to be gone for 2 months. 5 years later, he was still down in that part of the world sharing and leading in the work. And he's still working today after, 14, almost 15 years. The things that happened in Tonga, they started with a one-week fast and fasting time and prayer. And we'd scheduled the time, and we really hadn't planned this in the natural, all it meant. But God showed us to have it at a certain time, and it was in the northern summer months. That happened to be the time of the coronation of the king. And so as a result, over half of the population of the nation came into the capital. A fabulous time for evangelism. And they began by fasting and prayer. They began to go out then and preach on the streets, and people started getting converted. In one, Kalafi's sister, Meliani, began to move and powerfully in God, and she started praying for her people in her high school. She saw personally over 100 of her student friends come to the Lord. And it became, there came on her a real persecution from the school leaders. She was kicked out of school. Her parents were embarrassed. Her father was one of the heads of education for the nation. They locked her up in her room, all embarrassed, like she was in prison. She slipped a note out to my sister, Lindo, and she said, "I'm growing stronger in the Lord through fasting and prayer." And ultimately, God showed her parents that this really was of God, and they turned around as well and became supportive. They were preaching out in one area, and one of the girls' purses was stolen. And so the thief ran away with it and found nothing in it but gospel literature. They had been praying for the king and his family, and that purse was thrown over a fence into the backyard of the king. And the prince, the little boy, picked it up. There were visitors there, and he began to give it out to the visitors. They want to know what this was about. It was all gospel. And it was very interesting how the Lord worked. But through that, the king became aware of the presence of the team, and he invited them personally to preach the gospel prior to the coronation. So for 2 hours, they shared the gospel as people were there from all over the world, but especially all over the Tongan nation. And they stood and preached the gospel right there, and then the king was crowned. It was a learning time for us because many miracles took place. I was recently back in Tonga. Today, the Prime Minister of Tonga is saved as a result of that particular crusade, that outreach. In fact, he was Isilele Taukolo is the leader of YWAM in Tonga, and he was really saved through that outreach. And then he went to New Guinea and later joined the team there, went back to be the leader there, and he has led the Prime Minister and his family to Christ. But I recently heard Kalafi was telling me that there are over 80 full-time pastors and evangelists in the nation or out from the nation that were saved during this 67 outreach. So multiplication in terms of not just souls but leaders who are today winning souls took place. And it was a true move of God. In the development of the schools, the Lord began to show us to multiply in the training to incorporate all that was being done by God in evangelism so that we could have the stability of the workers. And so when we started here, we didn't know how fast this would multiply, but God began to bless it. And our next school was started then, one in New Jersey, one in Germany. And then we started another school in England, and little by little, the schools began to be started in almost every nation of Western Europe. Then it began to go down into Africa, South Africa, and Rhodesia, as Rudy Locke took the vision down there and planted the schools there. And Ramona Jensen began to go down. Ian Muir went to East Africa, where Rudy had already blazed a trail, and he began to follow through. Today he's leading in Southern Africa. We have a school in Kenya. I was there just a few months ago in September, and we had 8 tribes represented among the student body, all studying to work for God, worshiping God together. And tribalism is very strong in Africa, and it is the major destructive force, really divisive force, among the nations. Westerners do not understand the African situation. Tribalism reigns there. And so we think it's something of democracy and everybody gets a vote and all of this. And we don't understand the setting. It just is culturally so different, and yet we are imposing on them things that are are very strange to their culture. But we find that if God is in something, that he can unite across all cultural barriers. That's the important thing. As our schools began to multiply around the world, God began to show us ways that that we were to be involved in actually teaching nations. Now, how can you teach a nation? Yet the Bible says we are to go into all the world and teach all nations. It was at that time that God gave us six ways in which you could teach a nation. One is through the family. Any nation presently is being taught negatively or positively through the family, the home. Even if the home is institutional, they're getting taught. The majority of the criminals, for example, in Germany, come from state-paid institutions in Germany because of the impersonality of the state system trying to raise children. It inevitably produces bitterness, and they go into antisocial activities. God would like positive teaching in the homes. He wants that personal relationship. He wants something that will teach of him. And so as Christians, we must see the family as a God-given institution, the most basic of all, and then build that up. Satan is trying to tear it down through all kinds of immorality and division and strife and bitterness. The second is the church. The church was also instituted by none other than the Lord himself. And at a local level, the church is to be the fellowship of the family of God. We must not give up on the church. And even if it's dry bones, remember the resurrection power of Jesus Christ is what saved us and what will raise us from the dead. And so one of the callings of Youth with a Mission is to renewal of the church. And if we don't believe in this, then we can't believe in the power of the resurrection of Christ. God is asking us to walk some narrow roads right now in this area. And we don't know where all it will lead us. But if we are following the Lord in it, I know, for example, I saw in 1965, I was in Mexico. And I was driving down through Mexico with the teams, and we just stopped, and we'd had a blowout on one of our tires, so we had a street meeting in town, and then we got back into the cars after the tire was fixed, and there were five of our vehicles. And the last vehicle in line had an accident. And by the time the word got up to me in the front vehicle, we went back. The car had flipped over, and they had rushed the young driver to the hospital. It's just a little primitive hospital. And there in the hospital, the doctor said everything was seemingly all right. He had a little cut and so on. But then he began to bleed out his nose and ears and mouth, and they realized something very bad was wrong. They started to rush him in to the hospital at Querétaro, the bigger city. And it looked like he wouldn't live. And he lay on my lap on the way in, and a very difficult time for me as I prayed over that young man. And it was in Querétaro that he had surgery. They found a piece of bone laying against his brain, and he was able to not only live, but live in a very normal way again. We thank the Lord for that. A lot of prayer went up in that town as we waited for those days to pass. It was the following year, maybe 2 years later, Wedge Allman took a team to that very town of Querétaro. And as he went into the town, he found a priest who was so hungry for God. And he said, "I've never been saved." And he led him to Christ. And then he said, "Would you come and preach at the Mass?" He went into the church with 6,000 people there and preached the gospel. Hundreds came forward for salvation. And the priest began to gather a group around him of young people, and they went to the streets and started preaching the gospel. I noticed something happened there that opened my eyes. They began to taunt, jeer, and persecute and throw rocks at the priests and the others that were with him, his own young people from his church, when they got in earnest about Jesus. I saw reality there, and I saw that persecution does not follow any other lines other than reality in Christ when the devil gets stirred and mad. Because there is no persecution there, I always thought, for Catholics. That's a Catholic nation. But I found that as life started to flow, they received the same persecution that the Protestants did in that nation. So it was a spirit over that nation, and I was looking at the flesh, trying to discern spiritual matters. We're still trying to do that. There are 800 million Catholics, and with just a small fraction of that number are Protestants in the world, and we still look at people in groups, and Jesus is looking at individuals. And I believe that any kind of ism, Protestantism, Catholicism, YWAMism, or any other ism is idolatry. We must not look at people as though they are masses of people of any kind, of any label. The minute you put labels on people, that's the minute you start to be prejudiced and cannot reach them. If you're talking, oh, they are a Buddhist or Muslim or whatever, at that moment you cease to be effective with them. You've already presuppose certain things about that particular person. I believe that God has asked us to look on the fields and see the people with compassion that Jesus saw, rather than with prejudiced views of what they are or are not. And I see this even in the studying of cults. I studied the cults, and I wanted to become very good at knowing what this cult did and how to out-argue them. And I found through argument I never won one person from those cults, ever. I confronted them. I drove them from Jesus, because Jesus was not in the Spirit, was not flowing through me. And I found that if I would just put aside the labels and learn everything I could about Jesus, and move in the opposite spirit to what Satan was moving in, I found there was a reality that could flow through and go over these so-called barriers. And they were barriers more in my mind than they were in the things out there. And so we need to confront, not in the flesh, but by the Spirit. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty, through the pulling down of strongholds. But if we walk in the flesh, as though we are battling in the flesh, we're going to always miss the issue. And we get involved in intellectual pride, throwing around what we have learned against what they have learned, and we end up with nothing but an ego trip and Satan being exalted, because he is the father of pride. Now, it was in that understanding that God was trying to say to us, get away from your prejudices and get to the people. Get to the people. And the issue is Jesus. It's always the issue. If anything else becomes the issue, then you've got an idolatrous diversion in your life. And the Bible is far more against idolatry and speaks far more against it than it does murder, adultery, or any other sin. Idolatry. As far as the bulk of the pages and the chapters of the Bible, idolatry, time and again, led them into all those other sins. And so we must fix our eyes on Jesus. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. Not fix our eyes on people, on movements, on doctrine, on anything else. Fix your eyes on Jesus, and all other things will find its right place in God. And so that's the focus. And by their fruits ye shall know them. I was just about to share a while back on how we pick the teachers, and that's how I got off onto some of the other stories and things. But I've found that it's very important that the teachers are chosen in the plan of God. But I watched as we had a diversity of teachers. We had, well, Duncan Campbell would get up and he'd speak, and he'd start out, "I'm a Calvinist," in his Scottish brogue. And the week before, we would have Gordon Olson. He'd say, "I'm an Arminian." And here you had Arminian Calvinists. We had non-charismatic charismatic. Now, neither Olson or Campbell would talk about being charismatic. They didn't consider themselves that. But then we would have those that would consider themselves charismatic. And I found out that in the depth of their teaching, in the spiritual flow, there was not a contradiction. The contradictions came in semantics, the words that were used, and they came in the periphery of their teaching. Not in the mainstream, the periphery. So I began to say to the students, now God has shown us that we are to minister from all the body of Christ to all the body of Christ and to the world. Now, where is the body of Christ? Well, it's those that are following the Lord. Well, you say, how can you know the real from the counterfeit? I heard a tape from a Baptist preacher once. He was in Texas. He was a Texan. And he said that God called him to minister to the Catholics, to minister with the Catholics in South America. And he said, God, I can't do that. I can't work with anyone that I don't agree with, and I don't agree with all they do. And he said, the Lord said to him, I work with you and I don't agree with all you do. Now, what I said to the students, and I've been saying it ever since, every man or woman of God that comes and shares, they have a deep flow in the river of God that they're a part in, and in the river of their life, the depth is right in the middle. And every man or woman of God, and we don't want anyone else, they've got that depth there. You go for the depth, and you will not find problems of contradiction. But every teacher, including the one speaking now, has banks to his river. And there's mud along the banks. And there's muddy water. And you can take the mud off of the banks of one teacher and throw it at the other teacher over and even bring conflict between the banks of the two rivers. And if so, I want you to know you're a mudslinger and your problem is in your heart. You're not after truth, you're after controversy. And you have no place in the school if that's what you're here for. If you are wanting truth of God, you're not going to say to one teacher, but last week we heard this. Because you're not trying to find what God is saying, you're trying to get him pitted against the other. And that's not promoting unity, that's promoting everything else but. But if you are longing for the truth of God, you're going to be in the depth of the middle of that river, and you're going to be bringing up the truths of God from the pure, clear streams. And that's going to feed you, and you'll grow. I've watched the two things happen through the years. Those that grow in God, those that become true leaders, are not those that are wanting to cause divisions and controversies. Titus 3 says, watch out for the factious man, because if he's warned to the second time, then cut him off, because you know that he has sin in his life. He is sinning. It's not the issue up here, it's the sin in his life. That's what the Bible says, Titus 3, 9 and 10. So in this understanding, you can have from all the walks of life, all the different viewpoints, and what it will do, it will stretch your understanding, and allow you to see the depth of the flow of God in the Spirit of truth, the freedom that it brings you into, and you will also be able to see, yes, there's no one perfect. If everyone had truth, if any one person had truth, then the rest of us aren't needed. I saw something else about truth, that truth being from God is infinite. Anyone disagree? We have an opportunity to drink from an infinite well of truth. If truth is infinite, and this board would represent all truth, how much do you think any one of us would know of that infinite truth? This much? No. Our little finite minds hold so little that we really couldn't say out of that which is infinite that we would have even a small point. Now, this is not to say that all roads are right either. But we are talking about the basics of truth in Jesus Christ. There is a tremendous breadth of understanding, and if we ever feel that we've got it and others don't, there's something of the heart called intellectual pride that bottles over our minds and we're not able to receive. But it's that guilelessness of a child, that openness that even becomes your protection, because the Bible says the Holy Spirit will lead you into all truth. And truth, if it's anything, has to be the spirit of truth, because the letter alone killeth. And if the letter of truth kills, the spirit, and the spirit brings life, we want the spirit of truth. Now, God has put truth down in written form, but again, it's the spirit of the truth of the Word of God that brings life. The Word of God was breathed into existence. And that's what we call the inspired Word of God. It was by the Holy Spirit, as the Holy Spirit came upon men of God of old, and they wrote under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So you must read under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to receive that which God has. And not get the letter that kills, but the spirit of the truth that brings life. As God spoke to us then regarding the third area to teach a nation was education, schools. We felt that God wanted us to start schools. Now, not schools of evangelism and discipleship training schools. The way that developed is as the need arose and the Jesus people came in and they'd brought with them all of their problems they'd picked up on drugs and occult and everything, we found that first section of the school of evangelism called the messenger had to be extended out. And that became the discipleship training school, where we learned the ways of God, getting to relate to God, to His Word, to one another, and understanding spiritual warfare against the enemy and temptation in our life, and then evangelism is the last. Then evangelism portion then was expanded in the schools of evangelism. So this began to happen around the world, and you will hear the two different terminologies and sometimes maybe come confused by them. But it was a growth process. But as God spoke to us about education then, He showed us that we were to start schools for children at the preschool level. And then we were to start and raise those ages right on up. Academic training, some call it, but we saw that the difference between Christian training and academic training was not a difference. It was all of God if it was truth. If you're talking mathematics, God is the mathematician. He's the God of order, the Bible says. The God of faithfulness, speaking of natural law. And you go through the attributes of God and you'll find that anything that we call academic is really related and rooted in God if it is truth. And if it is not, we shouldn't be teaching it anyway. We don't have enough time to teach all the deceptions of Satan, so let's get to the truths of God. And in doing so, you will best prepare the young people to face the future. Now, the Bible also says in Psalms 1:1 that we're not to walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of the sinner, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. Many schools have seats of scorn and ways of sinners. And if I can't, as an adult, walk in the way of sinners and so on, how could I put my little child into that situation? I couldn't. I couldn't allow my child to go, this is a personal conviction, to sit under a teacher teaching atheism, teaching concepts of atheistic humanism, and distortions of values and so on. I just couldn't do that and fulfill the word of God to me as a parent to train up that child in the way they should go. And so it became incumbent upon us that we start schools. But not just for ourselves, but for those that were round about us. We called them the International Christian Schools, and we started in the form of we've been working on a curriculum, a development program as well, and we have various curricula now in varying stages. The next thing was to start a university, and God spoke to us regarding the university, finally confirmed it in 1977 that at the International Council when we were in Finland, that we were to have the university. I went from there, flew back to Dallas, Texas, where I met at the airport Leonard Ravenhill, and we were just to spend a day in prayer, and the Dawsons flew in as well, and they're old friends of Leonard Ravenhill as well. And we spent 8 hours that day in prayer. Just, we had come to pray with Leonard regarding his own ministry. But during the day, you try to minister to someone else like that, and you inevitably get ministered to. It's just God's ways. One hand washes the other, and God binds us together in unity. And so we were there praying for his burdens. And I love to pray with Leonard. I have through the years. And when he prays, I always take notes. He preaches. I mean, he gives outlines like I've never heard. And he just prays out. He's a prophet of God. And I just write like crazy. And he's quite a guy. But about 2 hours into the prayer time, he began to rise up in his spirit and say, "Oh God, you're showing me to pray for this spiritual university out in Kona, Hawaii." Who told him? I didn't tell him. No one knew but the International Council. And I was waiting for confirmation to come at all the different group levels. And so he went on praying for this spiritual university that's going to train young people to change the world. So I let him pray on. A couple of hours later, he came back and he said, "God, you're burdening me again." And he started in on this spiritual university. 2 hours later, he did it again. I thought, well, Lord, you're trying to tell me that I should at least encourage him. And so I said, "Leonard, you haven't heard a thing, but I need to tell you what God has just shown us, that we are to literally have a Christian university there in Kona, Hawaii." And praise God, and then he just took off. He began to see things. He said, "You know, God is going to use this to bring in Asians whose parents will not allow them to go to school in any other place other than a university, because Asia has as its big hang-up the bondage of the family, and they send their children away for university to come back and support mom, dad, and grandpa and grandma. And it's this constant, so that when Jesus said you have to go and leave father, mother, houses, or lands, he was talking to Asians that are held back by this. And our problem in the West is sometimes the other problem. But you see the both sides of this. And so God was going to use this to open doors for Asians to come in. And the name the Lord showed us was Pacific and Asia Christian University. God also spoke to a man by the name of Dr. Howard Malmstead. I shared with him the curriculum program. I shared it in a public way. And as I shared it publicly, he came up to me afterwards. He's a professor emeritus at the University of Illinois. He's world-renowned as a scientist, has received 11 major scientific awards, and he has been flown around the world by the UN to give scientific lectures and so on. He's just one of the top men in the world today in his category. One of the inventors of the microcomputer, has invented the most modern diagnostic equipment in the world, and he is Cynthia Bloomer's father. So You know probably now who he is and the link-ups and so on. Well, he came up to me, and he had been holding scientific seminars 3 weeks in length for a long time, and I shared with him how educationally that I had found in our schools. I'd shared this publicly that if you ever try to move with the world of television, for example, they move you toward a shorter and a shorter attention span. And they're really moving into a level that is causing us to be less and less adequate in going in-depth into any training. I watched in teaching here at Lausanne. As we would take off, it takes about 15 minutes to lock in to your teaching time. And then you begin to soar. Understanding occurs, and that attention span can be extended up to 2 hours before it begins to taper off. But when you stop again, then you have to take off again. And you lose a lot of time taking off and stopping. And he said, I've watched this he's done this now 14 years, where he would take scientists and for 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, with long periods of time, give them in-depth training. And they would pay hundreds and thousands of dollars for this course. But for 3 weeks' time, he was able to extend their learning beyond what a lot of people were learning over a semester or even 6 months in a normal course. And he wouldn't allow them to go out and make a phone call or anything. Intensive training. And this became, you know, a very famous course, and people flew in from all over the world to take it. And we clicked right away as the first time I met him. And God began to speak with him, and now God has called him to be a part, and now he's the Vice President of Academic Affairs for the Pacific and Asia Christian University. And so we've been flowing together, and the things the Lord showed us in the School of Evangelism are the things that we are to do, only we're adding them to the courses according to whatever the subject is. If you take history, you will only take history for 3 months. You will start with ancient history and move right on up through Grecian, Roman, medieval, right up to modern times. During that time, we will fly professors in from all over the world who are best in the category who are Christian, only Christian teachers. It's a Christian school, Christian students. It's not an evangelistic project, it's a training project. And so we will bring in the best. Then they have a project, either research, teaching, or in some way applying what they've learned in the first 3 months. During that time, they will take the equivalent of what most majors in history will take during a four-year time because of the intensive in-depthness of the course. Now, you can apply this out, but it's 3 months plus apprenticeship. It's visiting professors. It's intensive. You live together while you learn, and you can't work out. You can't do other things. It's total immersion. For example, in our Bible course, we have a Bible course starts in September. It goes for 9 months, 12 hours a day they're presently studying. They go through the Bible every verse five times. They go through the Bible five times in 9 months. They go through four different versions. They learn at the very beginning the techniques, and they are eating the Word. I don't know a Bible course anywhere in the world like it. I'm sure there may be, but they are becoming men and women of the Word. And so that's a part of it. You can't start any other place, because the first 3 days they learn the whole outline of the Bible. After that, they learn the techniques of study. After that, they study five times through the Word of God. Now, we're doing this in the various courses, and we presently have three colleges that you can take a bachelor's degree on, one that you can take only a master's, the other three you can also take master's degrees, and then we will have three other courses. They follow the seven different areas, six of them to turn the nations around, the home, the school, the church, the school, and so on. So we have the College of Counseling and Healthcare, the College of Christian Ministries, the College of Education, the College of Performing Arts, the College of Communication, the College of Humanities and International Studies, which deals with business and politics, the College of Science and Technology.